This is WNYT, Albany. Joe Moskowitz, meteorologist Norm Sebastian, and Rodger Wyland on sports. This is the 30-Minute News.
Good evening. The political crossfire is intensifying on this, the final weekend before Tuesday's election. Rensselaer County Sheriff Warren McGreevy was a target of accusations made outside his own jail today. The Civil Service Employees Association, which has endorsed McGreevy's opponent, Robert Schneeman, accused the sheriff of allowing a deputy to politic on his behalf on the taxpayers' time.
Sheriff McGreevy is not acting properly. He's actually paid a public employee to participate in a bogus endorsement of his candidacy for re-election.
The endorsement in question came from CSEA's very own Political Action Committee and is a focus of a rift within the union. In essence, it has endorsed both candidates. McGreevy denies doing anything wrong.
In order to take and do something on a basis of for the union, they have to request time off to do that, and I have to grant that under the contract, which I do. I mean, I've done that for all the members that belong to the union as officers and committee people.
The sheriff's office has been politically divided since McGreevy's defeat of Sheriff Eugene Eaton in the last election. Rensselaer County would love to have Saratoga County's new jail. The $9.8 million facility was dedicated today. A lot of counties would love to have its old jail. It isn't that old. It was built in 1969, but can't hold nearly enough inmates, and the cost of expansion would be prohibitive. In its place, a new state-of-the-art facility with an ultimate capacity of 140, more than twice the old downtown structure.
Everything is covered in this facility. State Commission of Corrections have approved it. The classification, all of our programs are here, and we now have the size and the room to take care of and operate a good correction facility.
The new facility will allow the county to stop farming out inmates to other counties. That costs about $65 a day. As of yesterday, 30 inmates were being held in other counties. The new jail also has spaces for women and for those with communicable diseases.
This area here, this area, and this area, these are maximum security. And the rest of the other three areas, they're all medium.
Well, okay, now what is the difference between a maximum security cell?
Well, the maximum security cells are the cells that slide.
Okay.
All the doors slide. Medium,
they swing out.
They bolt open and they pop open.
There are doors, but there are no bars. For now, there are no inmates. That will change by late November. Today, there was a party, so it wasn't surprising that there were some partying-looking people walking through the halls. An overnight fire chased five families into the street in Albany. The blaze burned through a row of houses with flames rising 30 feet in the air. Phil Bailey reports.
The fire broke out after almost everyone had gone to bed in the row of homes on Broad Street. No one was injured. It started at about 1 a.m. in Viola Wilson's apartment at 65 Broad Street.
The mattress was smoldering, as far as I know, but we thought we had put it out. I don't know how the fire started. I don't know.
Three buildings were burned, and the fire forced 15 people into the street.
The damage is very bad on the second floor of 65. It's almost completely burnt off. There is some bad burn in 63 where the fire burned through the walls into two rooms and the roof.
In the fire's wake, eight tenants are homeless. Two of the buildings will be boarded up. But Viola Wilson lost even more than her belongings. And she's lived with for 6 years, now is sitting in prison. Bruce Robinson was arrested for disorderly conduct at the fire scene, for allegedly interfering with firefighters when he thought someone was still inside.
He was trying to get in and see if anybody was in the house. He was abusive, yes, but he was trying to check and see if anybody was in the house.
Wilson says she can't raise the $500 bail and can't believe she has to when her life already has been reduced to rubble. Phil Bailey, the 30-Minute News, Albany.
A Warren County man is in jail tonight on charges stemming from a fire that ripped through his home and killed three of his children. Sheriff's officials say 28-year-old Daniel Hayes is being held without bail on charges of criminally negligent homicide for the October 15th fire at his home on Route 28 in the town of Johnsburg. Authorities say they believe Hayes touched off the blaze by burning insulation off of copper wire. Coming up next on the 30-Minute News, area Trekkies explore a strange new world. A former Troy man has been ordered deported from the U.S. George Theodorovich had been accused of a number of Nazi war crimes and was under investigation by the federal government since 1983. Theodorovich has been told he can go to the country of his choice. He chose Argentina, but the whole matter is still under appeal. Theodorovich reportedly opened fire on a group of Jews in a Ukrainian city while he was an officer with the Nazis. The Fenimore Bridge between the town of Moreau and Hudson Falls in Saratoga County has been reopened to traffic. The span was closed in September because of erosion under one of the concrete footings. The State Department of Transportation has made some modifications to the bridge to allow automobiles to use it again. Truck and bus traffic is still restricted, though, and a new bridge at the site won't be built until sometime in the 1990s. Space, the final frontier. But to true Star Trek fans, there's no such thing as final. The voyages continue through two decades, two casts. No one has gone to... These are scenes from Star Trek, The Next Generation. All new episodes being shown on more than 200 stations. It has almost an entirely new cast. Only Scotty still responds to beam me aboard requests. And that has some serious Trekkies upset.
Well, like, we're used to seeing, you know, Admiral Kirk, strong, authoritative, father-like figure that I can look up to. And the new guy, he looks like the old guy on the street walking his dog or something. He doesn't give you that feeling. And there's no Vulcans. I love the Vulcans, and there's no Vulcan.
But it's the popularity of the old show that fuels the interest in the movies and the new show. And the new Star Trek appears to be attracting a generation of its own viewers.
I love it. I think it's still got the old magic there.
I like it a lot. I think it's it could be a little more original, but I think it has potential to be very good.
They want the new phasers, the phasers they're using on the new show, which nobody has right now. T-shirts, the communication device, they offer all sorts of things.
If you're willing to pay the prices that they're charging for some Star Trek collectibles, someone might refer you to a Vulcan psychologist for a mind meld. Phasers can go for $100. Speaking of space, just ahead on the 30-Minute News, an old face returns. Normie! It is Halloween, and on this day, it seems altogether fitting and proper that we announce the return of one of the members of our weekend family. Yes, it's meteorologist Norm Sebastian. This tape shows him recovering from back surgery at Albany Medical Center. At least, that's what he's trying to make you believe. Actually, it's a seedy hotel room after he was humiliated in the wrestling ring. Pro wrestling is his first love. Oh, you don't believe he was wrestling? Does this look like a man with a bad back? In fact, here's a picture of him after this match, praying that he will do much better in the wrestling ring. And so, without further ado...
Good afternoon, everybody. Hey!
Norm, welcome back. We certainly missed you.
Joe, that was a funny story there.
It's the truth, Norm.
Remember, I only have to be nice to you as long as that red light's on. It says so on my contract.
Oh, when are you going to... Well, actually, we really are very, very happy to have you back. And folks out of Albany Medical Center, great job. It's almost a medical miracle you're back this soon.
Yeah,
it really is.
I really feel a lot better. And, you know, I'm taking it easy still. A few more weeks of taking it easy. But after that, you know...
Looking great.
Thank you, Joe. And I'll tell you what, it was a great day. What a segue into... the weather, and today it was nice outside, a lot of sunshine, 56 was a high, 43 the low, and you can see we are above the norm for this date. And outside right now, it's starting to cool off a little bit with clear skies. Temperature down, 48 degrees. Where'd you get that wrestling footage anyhow? 33 degrees dew point, relative humidity in the 50s, and the barometer is rising rather rapidly too. The wind's out of the west-northwest at 6, precipitation none today, and our sunrise and sunset times, in case you're wondering, here they are for you. We have sunset tomorrow night at 4:48. Showing you what's going on across the rest of the northeast. It's a pretty chilly night, but most of the region is clear. I say most of it because there are a few clouds over northeastern Vermont. 18 degrees at Mount Washington, 44 now is our current reading. And Portland, you can see out to the west too, 40s and 30s. And it was on this date in history, we can't forget it, 1925, Garfield, Vermont, I don't know where that is, 2 degrees. Pittsburgh, New Hampshire was 4. It's up here in northern New Hampshire. Very chilly across the Capital District that morning. And in 1965, Fort Lauderdale had 14 inches of rain. And this day, they had 42 inches in 1 month. And that is what I call amazing. Now, looking outside right now, a lot of clear sky. There are a few clouds, as we pointed out, in northeastern Vermont, but most of the nation was not as lucky as we were today because there are an awful lot of clouds around Florida, also in the central part of the U.S., and a big storm making its way into the West Coast. Believe it or not, though, over the next couple of days, this high-pressure system you see up here in Canada is going to dominate our weather. This low-pressure center is really going to try to make it into our region. For that reason, tomorrow afternoon, I think we may see a few clouds, but I think it's going to push out to our south. I don't think it has enough strength to make it into the Albany area. Down south around New York City, though, there may be a shower. While the west remains wet, we have another storm right on the heels of this one. But again, no rain in the foreseeable future. Skywatch radar showing the showers and thunderstorms over the Mississippi Valley back in Southern California where it never rains. And the Skywatch radar, I should say the jet stream, shows a northwest wind flow over us, and that is what's going to keep all the rain that's sitting down to our south out of here. I think we keep this northwest flow at least into early Wednesday. So all in all, we have a pretty dry forecast, and that is reflected in words. Right now, let's show you what we have for tonight. Forecasting clear and chilly weather, 26 to 31. Now, this is here in Albany. If you're up around Glens Falls, the protected valleys in Vermont, you may get down into the teens, so keep that in mind. Tomorrow, we're looking for mostly sunny skies and mild conditions. Scattered clouds in the afternoon, 58 to 63, an absolutely gorgeous day with light winds. Tomorrow night, patchy clouds and cool with lows of 30 to 35. And moving on down the road to Monday, mostly sunny skies and light winds, 58 to 63, our extended forecast. Calling for dry and warm Tuesday. A front may make it in here on Wednesday morning, but even with that, not an awful lot of showers. There are a lot of people I'd like to thank. First of all, Dave Huntress from WPTZ-TV, Dr. Wallman, Dr. Pop up here in Albany Medical Center. I'll get out of the way so you can see all the names here. 6th floor and 7th floor. They had me on 2 floors, Joe, at once. And well, I'd also like to thank everybody here at the station for really helping me out during my little vacation. And last but not least, I'd like to thank the man upstairs. Let's roll the videotape showing you what I missed when I was gone. And I'm really, really glad, Joe, that I missed this storm, because I don't know if I would have hit it. However, the guys at the National Weather Service said that they took a poll, and 70% of them said that they thought I might have hit it if I were working. Hit the storm right on the head.
Norm, I have absolutely no doubt in my mind, had you been here, we would have known. We all would have packed up and moved. In fact, you told me some of the weather stuff you saw. You kind of had an inkling this was going to happen.
Yeah, an inkling. That's what they say. Yeah.
He had an inkling.
I had a feeling it was going to snow here pretty soon.
And so that's why you took it off, because I'm just going to sit inside. I have to worry. They got generators.
That was
there,
unreal,
no problem.
Wasn't it?
That sure was.
I really had to laugh a little bit, but not too much, because after I saw the damage,
yeah,
it wasn't funny.
But. Well, we're so glad you're back.
It's glad to be here. Very
okay.
much so.
And the rest of the gang, Roger, he's up next, and he'll tell us about RPI opening its 1987 hockey season tonight. Roger's going to have a preview of that, plus big news concerning Eric Dickerson and highlights from the big game in college football. All next. More trouble tonight for a popular Albany prizefighter. Elijah Tillery has been released on his own recognizance after being charged with menacing. He's accused of pulling a gun on Robert Burke at 3rd and Larkin, Albany last night. Burke jumped through a window at a fire station allegedly to escape the boxer, but Tillery denies he had a gun and claims he was arrested only because of his neighborhood's bad reputation.
Last night, you know, the area where my wife and my children is, you know, it's infested with, you know, drugs and, you know, pot and, you know, crime, et cetera. And, you know, it's hard for the people that live there that are honest now to even walk the streets. You know, so what they're doing is they're just, you know, everybody they see, they're parading on, you know, the police, they're just jumping on.
Tillery says he's being harassed because he has filed a $1.5 million lawsuit against Albany County after an arrest a year ago that never resulted in an indictment. The surprise, well, now, actually, they are a good team, and they've shown signs of it for the last couple of years, but I think a lot of people have to be surprised about the Orangemen, though.
They're now 8-0, Joe, and if you look at the rest of their schedule, I think they got a great shot at going undefeated because they play at Navy, yeah, that they have two home games with Boston College,
yeah,
and West Virginia.
Navy showed how powerful they are today.
Yeah, against Notre Dame. We'll have more on that in a moment. But, you know, come to think of it, if Syracuse wanted to play in a major bowl on January 1, and if they wanted to play for a possible national championship, well, then they had to win today in Pittsburgh against the Panthers, and they did just that. Don McPherson, the quarterback, first quarter to Tommy Kane, 49 yards here, and it would set up a McPherson touchdown on the option play, and he does this so well, and it was 10-0. This just reminded me of the Penn State game a couple of weeks ago. I mean, they started so fast in Pittsburgh. It became 17-0 here when McPherson, and watch how he gets away from the rush and goes to his tight end, Pat Kelly. It would make it 17-0. McPherson has thrown 9 touchdown passes in the last 3 weeks. Just before half, McPherson goes to his favorite, Tommy Kane. It was 24-3 Syracuse. McPherson had 2 touchdown passes today. Freshman quarterback Darnell Dickerson, though, rallied Pitt in the third quarter. Goes to Craig Hayward to make it 24-10. They would get no closer. Without Ted Gregory, the big starting nose guard, who has the knee injury, played only a few downs, and yet without him and Terry Wooden, who didn't even make the trip, they still held Pitt to 10 points, and they win it. 24-10 was the final score. And it's looking good. Bring on Oklahoma, huh? Look at this score, 71-10. I don't know why Barry Switzer likes to run up the scores against teams like Kansas. But anyway, Oklahoma and Nebraska will meet November the 21st. Elsewhere, Miami over East Carolina. UCLA won, or is leading in the third quarter, over Arizona State. Notre Dame bested Navy. Tim Brown, 173 all-purpose yards. Iowa rolled over Indiana, and for Indiana, that's their first loss in the Big Ten this year. Clemson came back at home to beat Wake Forest 31-17. Look at Boston College in the upset today. Boston College over Tennessee. Now, that score should read 20-18. Boston College wins 20-18, and Ohio State is trailing right now, Michigan State, in the fourth quarter. Penn State won today over West Virginia. It was Army over Temple, and there's the Army score, 17-7. And Columbia, number 38, straight losses for Columbia. Lehigh wins 26-10. Now, before we get back to the rest of the day in college football, major announcement in the NFL, and it will make Eric Dickerson the highest-paid running back in the league. Earlier this afternoon, unhappy L.A. Ram running back became the sole property of the Indianapolis Colts. Rams traded Dickerson to the Colts, where he inked an incredible 4-year deal worth $5.6 million. To make room for Dickerson, the Colts sent their number one pick of 87, unsigned Cornelius Bennett, to the Buffalo Bills, and in return, for giving up a franchise player, the Rams will receive the Colts' top 2 draft picks of next season, Buffalo's first-round choice through Indianapolis, 3 second-round picks, and running back Greg Bell. Dickerson might play against the Jets tomorrow at the Meadowlands. Back to college football now. It's been a tough year thus far for Coach Al Bagnoli and Union, but they look strong today as the Dutchmen were home against Williams College, and they got a big performance from Darrell Shepard, the senior tailback, at 182 yards on the ground, and they also had a big performance from their quarterback. Jimmy Poyer is injured, so senior Mike Gargiulo, who was the starter at the beginning of the year, tossed 2 touchdown passes. This one covered 40 yards. So Shepard and Gargiulo, big days. Union 31-7 over Williams. Al Bagnoli will be our guest on Big Board Sports Coach's Corner Sunday night at 11:30. Elsewhere today, RPI won 23-21 over WPI. Third straight win for them. Quarterback Kurt Sell had 2 touchdown passes in the last 5 minutes. In high school football, 2 winners in the Big Ten include Troy at Amsterdam. Amsterdam trying to get back to the Super Bowl. In the Suburban Council, Gilderland over Niskayuna. Shaker blanked Columbia 24-0. No score on Burn Hills. Yes, we do. 14-9. Burn Hills over Bethlehem. And Colony over Catholic Central as Chuck Dukes ran for a couple of more touchdowns. And away from football, tonight is the opening of another RPI college hockey season. Coach Mike Edessa's Engineers home tonight, 7:30 start against Babson. Last year, the Engineers were 13-18-2 overall and finished 7th in the regular season in the ECAC. This year's team will be young, but Odessa is confident the results will be better.
I think we certainly will not be the favorite. I'd guess that a lot of people pick us 5th, 6th, somewhere in that range. Yet I think we could be 5th, 6th. We probably could be 7th, 8th.
Could you be 1st?
But I think we got an outside shot of being 1st, 2nd.
Sounds interesting. Go over and check them out tonight. Face-off tonight is set for 7:30, and of course we'll have highlights for you at 11.
Okay, thanks a lot, Roger.
Thank you, Joe.
Still ahead on the 30-minute news, Marriott children celebrate a safer Halloween.
The witching day is upon us. It's Halloween, and Phil Bailey reports from the biggest Halloween bash of them all, the Kids Fair Halloween Party, co-sponsored by TV 13, for kids' sake.
Witches, goblins, and ghouls have taken control of the Capital District. Nearly 5,000 of them gathered in a ghostly apparition at SUNY Albany's Page Hall today. Gremlins and gorillas got together at the Kids Fair Halloween Party, co-sponsored by TV 13 and the Schenectady Gazette.
It's close to midnight, something evil's lurking in the dark. Under the moonlight, you see a sight that almost stops your heart. You try to scream, but terror takes the sound before you make it.
It attracted kids pretending to be adults and adults behaving a lot like kids. With music and magic, it was intent to make a safe Halloween a certainty. Phil Bailey, the 30 Minute News, Albany.
Kind of a shame that safety even has to be a concern, but nowadays I guess it does. And now,
yes,
the weather. Can't get over how wonderful it is to have you back, Norm.
Joe, stop. You're making me blush.
Okay, I'm lying, too. I mean, where's Dave? Come on.
We have some nice weather for tonight, so you're heading out trick-or-treating, no problems there. But the dry weather's going to continue for the foreseeable future.
Okay, what kind of candy do you have up there if I knock on your door?
I've got some candy corn. I got special treats for you after that story you had before.
Okay.
Nice to have you back, by the way, Norm.
Thanks, Roger.
Even the sports guy likes to have you back. Big Board Sports, Sunday night, 11:30. Jets and Colts from the Meadowlands will be there. Al Bagnoli on Coach's Corner. And we'll look back to the big high school game from Friday night, Shenandoah and Saratoga.
Speaking of the Colts, did they mortgage the future? I mean, several franchises' future just for that trade?
I think they did. They gave up a couple of first-round picks, and the Rams, I don't know. If I were the Rams, I would have never given up Eric Dickerson, but they did.
Yeah, well, if I were, I mean, I would have worked out a deal for just him for Greg Bell and a draft pick. Oh, well.
Well, I don't know. If you're the Colts, though, it should be very interesting because they got one heck of a talented running back.
Yeah, anything helps.
You bet.
And that's our news. I'm Joe Moskowitz. Thanks for watching. We'll see you again at 11:00.